First of all, hello everybody. Wow, that's the liveliest 8:15 crowd I've ever heard in my life. So this session is called Giants in Conversation, and then some subtitle about Rabbis Heschel and Soloveitchik that I no longer recall. I'm going to take a minute before I start to dedicate this session to the memory of Professor Arthur Hyman, who passed away a short while ago. And I would like to think that our pursuit of philosophy where it takes us is something he would have appreciated. So, yihi zichro baruch. So, I want to talk about Rabbis Heschel and Soloveitchik together on a very personal level, simply because they are two people I have spent much of my adult life reading, thinking about, arguing with, imagining conversations between, imagining how I might referee conversations between. And I thought I would take a stab at sort of sharing some first thoughts about what that conversation might look like. These two people knew each other, but their approaches to Judaism, Jewish theology, Jewish spirituality, Jewish ethics were radically different. They diverged in very fundamental ways. Because time is short, I'm going to say basically nothing biographical and only think together about ideas and texts. I will only say the following sentence biographically that may be relevant and may not be, I'm not honestly sure, is that one of the things I think that made them interesting characters is that they both had the sense of themselves as heirs of major strands of the Jewish tradition, right? Heschel really understood himself in many ways. The way that I think you can encapsulate that, if you understand what it means to be raised to be a Rebbe, for his bar mitzvah, Heschel was given Levi Yitzchak of Berdichev's tefillin to put on, right? In other words, he was somebody who, like, a tremendous sense of, like, you carry something. And Rabbi Soloveitchik, as you know, was in many ways the heir of the greatest, most illustrious family in the world of Lithuanian yeshiva learning. And a different topic for another year would be the ways in which they both continued and radically did surgery on the traditions they inherited. Something that is often, I think, less than fully understood. What I want to try and do is think together about three topics. Realistically, we'll probably only get to two of them. One of them is a topic I've spoken about before at Limmud, which is the question of the divergent ways they each think about what it means for prayer to be an attempt to overcome the ego. And I think they end up saying some really interesting things that have implications for anyone, you know, who thinks about prayer, who prays, who goes to shul and aspires to pray, whatever it might be. I think that conversation between them on this is actually really useful. And then stuff I've been thinking about a lot in the last year that I've never taught before, but I want to try to think out loud about, is the way they really, I think, dramatically disagree on the relationship between what it means to serve God on the one hand and to do what is ethically right on the other. And I think there you'll have a really profound chasm between the two of them and their approaches. If there is time, this got cut off from the packets, and maybe I should take that as a sign because I have an incredibly sophisticated theology of providence, I wanted to think about, you know, one of the things that was in some ways most heated between them was the issue of interfaith dialogue. And I wanted to maybe offer one lens, maybe I'll just do it very briefly, into sort of the nature of that disagreement and what's really at stake. Soloveitchik, as you may know, you know, vociferously opposed at least formal Jewish-Christian dialogue, and Heschel felt Jewish-Christian dialogue was one of the urgent moral and religious imperatives of his time. Okay, I'm going to pass around a packet with my usual caveat. Let me walk you through it, because otherwise it will seem completely random. Here are two things we're not going to talk about, just because I want to anticipate this. Number one, which one day I hope to be able to give a shiur about at Limmud, but I'm not there yet, is about their respective understandings of the relationship between halakha and agadah in Jewish spirituality. I feel like I have Heschel on this pretty clear, and Soloveitchik, who is, as always, more elusive and less consistent from essay to essay, I can't do it yet. I'm working on it. And then, finally, I think a really interesting place of intersection between them is the question of how religion ought to function in a technological society. That's something I've spoken about in the past, I think even at Limmud, and if you want to hear versions of that, they're on the Hadar website. So I'm going to leave that alone and start with the question of prayer. So many Jewish thinkers have argued that one of the central projects of praying is essentially overcoming the ego, or if you prefer, moving the ego away from the center of my consciousness, believing there are no more. But what does it mean to overcome the ego? So for Heschel, the project of overcoming the ego is essentially this. How do I overcome, this is my language, not his. How do I overcome the illusion that my consciousness is the center of the universe? And the way that I always like to explain this to people, if that sounds like abstract to you, think about it in a very concrete way. All of us, at significant moments of our lives, for great, probably even a bulk, the bulk of the time, imagine that our ego is the center of the universe because we have no choice. After all, we filter the entire universe through our own consciousness, right? And in fact, although those of you who have studied with me before know I am like totally opposed to the flattening of differences between religious traditions, that's a great temptation of the religious left in America to totally destroy difference in the name of celebrating it, right? We're all saying the same thing, which we're not. But almost every religious tradition you could encounter on some level has a set of practices aimed at exposing the idea that my consciousness is the center of the world as an illusion, right? My consciousness is no more the center of the universe than your consciousness is. My ego is no more the center of the universe than yours is. My needs are no more metaphysically central than yours are. That's a spiritual claim. It's an ethical claim, right? It's a lot of things rolled into one. So Heschel believed that prayer was one of Judaism's great tools. I think he thought it was Judaism's greatest tool to teach us to go from ego-centeredness to other-centeredness. And I would say other-centeredness with a small o, that is, being centered on the needs of other humans I encounter, and other-centeredness with a capital O, being centered around God, right? So my goal in praying is to cultivate a posture of being responsive to claims that are not derived from me, right? The fact that you need something makes a claim on me. The fact that I want something is not the only truth of the universe. Now, that may sound obvious, but as we all know, our lives are often one long battle of trying to learn that, or worse yet, one long project of deciding to forget that, right? So that's really fundamental for Heschel. How do we make space for the reality of other selves? Right? He really believed that at the end of the day, that was one of the core, most basic fundamental projects of religion that was incredibly easy to say and incredibly difficult to do. And even if you could do it, it was incredibly difficult to sustain. Right? And if that sounds abstract, again, think about moments in your life where you can think about having responded in a very real way to someone and 2 minutes later discovering, wow, I can also be selfish and horrible. Right? And the way that it's so easy to move between those two, right, places. You can look if you want, we're not going to read these together, at sources 1 and 2 on the page, where Heschel talks about the struggle between a focus on the self and a focus on what goes beyond the self. And what's important to him to say, I think it's important for all religious traditions to say this, is focusing on the self is not inherently bad. I need to have food and clothing and make a living, but focusing only on the self makes me a monster, right? It's very similar in a way to what Martin Buber teaches. I-it relationships are not bad. They're in fact necessary. The problem is when you live in a world in which I-it relationships are all there is, right? So the project is, how do I open myself up to that which is outside me making a claim on me? That is you and God, right? Making a claim on me. So Heschel's argument, right, is that we are engaged in moving from self-centeredness to God-centeredness. And he says, in his last English language book, he says, faith is the beginning of the end of egocentricity, right? It is the beginning of the end. Think about what that's like parallel to Reshit Smichat Gulatenu, right? It is the beginning of the end of egocentricity, meaning it's a very tenuous first step towards overcoming egocentrism. Now, I think it's one step further, and then we'll see why this is all relevant and why I'm talking about this and how Heschel and Soloveitchik disagree about this. Prayer, it's extremely important to Heschel, and I think he felt it was important to say this in America especially. Prayer is not primarily about self-expression. or at least not self-expression in the way that Americans colloquially use a term like that. We obsess about self-expression, he says, but ironically in modernity, we don't understand what that is. We think self-expression is about saying I. And paradoxically, this is my language, not his, but I think this is what he's saying. Paradoxically, the more we insist on that kind of self-expression, the farther away we get from our true self. Because actually, what a spiritually mature life comes to realize is the deepest form of self-expression is in responding to something that is not me. Do you follow what I just said? That makes sense? Right? In other words, the paradox, irony, I'm not sure what the right word here is that in modernity we have such an obsession with self-expression that we actually lose ourselves, our authentic selves, in the process. Right? We end up with the self that just wants all the time. Right? And that demands all the time. Why is all this relevant to tefillah? Okay? Heschel argues, this is source 3 for a minute, okay? Just look at this for a second. Religion is not expediency. Of all the things we do, prayer is the least expedient, the least worldly, the least practical. Expediency for Heschel is a very dirty word. It means that I'm focused on what can this do for me. Prayer, he says, is never about that, which is a strong claim to make about a tradition that seems to celebrate petitionary prayer. Right? I'm asking for stuff. And yet Heschel says prayer is the least expedient thing we do, which is surprising. And we have to kind of wrestle with what he means by that. He argues, right, that prayer is actually the discipline of, at least for a moment, forgetting about myself. How do I do that? In the moment of focusing on God, I discover or remember that I am in fact not the center of the universe, but God is, right? In the moment of focusing on God, I discover, right? I'm not the center of the universe. By the way, it took me a long time to realize this. I don't intend this as an apologetic, but I actually have come to really believe this. You know, so I spent a lot of years of my life hating high holiday tefillot because I thought that essentially they made God out to be an incredibly vain entity. I have to tell God not once, not twice, but 43 times how much more wonderful than I God is. And then suddenly it dawned on me after kind of years of reading philosophy that actually I think what the tefillah is consciously doing there is the process of training us to say you, and not just I all the time. That one of the reasons the High Holiday Liturgy does that over and over again is literally to train us in the discipline of putting something else at the very center of our consciousness and our scale of values. Maybe that's apologetics. I don't think it is. I actually think that's a core piece of what the High Holiday Liturgy is about. After all, when we say, God, we long for the day when you rule, when you are ultimate, in the more classical gendered language, when you are king, as opposed to either evil or my ego. Right? Okay, I'm going to take a couple more steps and then take kind of questions to make sure this is clear. Now, so how does this work? So you raise your hand, you say, Professor Heschel, with all due respect, the Amida is a bunch of moments of asking God for things. So how is prayer about forgetting the self? So look at source 5 for a minute. Let's read this together because it's totally fascinating. And if I may be so bold, not totally convincing, but fascinating, okay? He says the following, the focus of prayer is not the self. Prayer comes to pass in a complete turning of the heart toward God, towards God's goodness and power. It is the momentary disregard of our personal concerns, the absence of self-centered thoughts, which constitute the art of prayer. And then here we go. Feeling becomes prayer in the moment in which we forget ourselves and become aware of God. Footnote, one of the things that's implicit here is not every moment of davening is a moment of praying. Davening is what I do. Prayer is what happens now and again while I'm davening. Is that distinction clear? Yep. One of the most embarrassing moments of my life, I'm sure I've embellished this in my own memory because it was so horrifying to me. Some of you have heard me talk about this. I was an undergraduate in college. I was like 8 months back from yeshiva in Israel, which means I was like the smuggest kid you could ever imagine, right? I was just like, you know, it was horrible. And Ira Eisenstein, you know, famous Reconstructionist rabbi, probably at the time, he's probably 90. He comes to speak at my Hillel, and there's a group of like 8 of us who go hear him, and he says, how often do you pray? And smug little Shai Held says to the Reconstructionist rabbi who he looks down upon three times a day. And he looks at me and says, young man, I don't believe I asked you how often you daven. And I was like, wow, okay, so what would it be like to become part of the carpet, right? But it was very profound, and I think Heschel's actually saying something here. In other words, the project of davening becomes prayer at moments, right? So he says, listen to how he shifts the meaning of petitionary prayer. When we analyze the consciousness of a supplicant, we discover that it is not concentrated upon his own interests, but on something beyond the self. The thought of personal need is absent, and the thought of divine grace alone is present in his mind. Thus, in beseeching God for bread, there is one instant, at least, in which our mind is directed neither to our hunger nor to God, but to God's mercy. That instant, this instant, is prayer. Now, just to sort of like say this in English for a minute, right? So I'm davening Shmoneh Esrei, and I'm saying, you know, Rifa'enu Hashem v'nei rafeh, right? Heal us, God, so we can be healed. And for some of that time, I'm asking for healing. But there comes a moment when I am actually, in what appears to be a petition, praising God for being a healer. What Heschel does, in other words, is take petitionary prayer and say that when it ripens and matures, it is in fact a form of praise. Now, I am not going to go around the room and say how many people have this experience regularly, okay? But let me say this in like philosophies for a minute, right? What Heschel does is say, look, I understand that I'm an heir of a tradition that says that the Amida is the core Jewish prayer. It is what Chazal call, the sages call, tefillah, right? When they simply use the word prayer, they're referring to the Amida. So what do I do? It's not about the words. It's about the phenomenology of the person doing the praying. I understand that the words look like they're requesting things, but in fact, in the moment when prayer blossoms, when davening becomes prayer, I'm not asking for anything at all anymore. I'm simply thinking about God's grace and how much God gives me that God doesn't owe me. Convincing or not convincing? Yeah, okay, so, right. So let me say this, if this is helpful. It is totally clear to me, I think it is beyond question, right? That's what someone says when they don't really have a good argument. But it is totally clear to me that had Heschel been a member of Chazal, right? One of the like 600 people over 600 years who made our lives in different ways, he would have argued that the word tefillah should refer to Psukei Dezimra. And he lost, right? Tefillah came to refer to the Amida. So what does he do? He ends up saying no, but at some moment at least, petition is not really petition. Petition too is praise. Okay? Now, bear with me for one more minute, and then I'm going to take questions about this. You can look at Source 6 where he basically says this. In Jewish liturgy, praise rather than petition ranks foremost. As my late mother used to say, O sheken o shelo. Right? He might be right, he might not be right. It's not obvious that he's right if you're just reading the rabbinic corpus, right? In the more profound, it is the more profound form, for it involves not so much the sense of one's own dependence and privation as the sense of God's majesty and glory, or as he would say elsewhere, of God's giving, God's grace. Not just God being majestic, but God being generous. Okay? Now, before I say anything about why Soloveitchik thinks this is basically crazy and wrong, questions about whether what I just tried to say was clear. Before we offer rejoinders to it, let's just make sure we have it, and then I'll talk about Soloveitchik briefly, and then we can discuss from it. What does Soloveitchik say? And here I want to acknowledge, talking about Soloveitchik is more complicated, because as a rule, with caveats, but as a rule, Heschel is fairly consistent in his theology over the course of his career. There really is, on most issues, no early and late Heschel. Soloveitchik is arguably not consistent from essay to essay. He takes these, no, that wasn't his project. His essays are arguably, some people disagree with this, his essays are arguably snapshots of what things look like at a particular moment from a particular lens. I mean, People always laugh when I say this, but I'm not actually joking. I once started working on an essay which was called, Is Halachic Man Lonely? Which I was sort of trying to figure out, like, just exactly how those two essays, The Lonely Man of Faith and Halachic Man, graph onto each other. And I basically stopped because I couldn't figure out whether the very project was misguided. The Soloveitchik would say, that's not particularly an interesting question. I was never up to that. Okay, other people disagree with that. Larry Kaplan, for example, argues like there is a unified corpus. I'm skeptical, but he may be right. Okay, so that said, there is a theme in in Soloveitchik's very diverse essays on tefillah that emerges again and again. And think about how different this is. Look at source 7 for a minute. Prayer as a personal experience, as a creative gesture, is possible only if and when man discovers himself in crisis or in need. That is why the Jewish idea of prayer differs from the mystical idea, insofar as we have emphasized the centrality of the petition, while the mystics have stressed the relevance of the hymn. Since prayer flows from a personality which finds itself in need, despondent and hopeless, its main theme is not praise or adoration, but rather request, demand, supplication. In other words, everything Heschel said is basically totally wrong. Jewish prayer is about petition, and it comes from an acknowledgement of my radical dependence and vulnerability. And I'll just say, and I mean this, let me underscore this point in no disrespectful way. One of the challenges I think some modern readers have, especially if they don't grow up in a culture that valorizes Rabbi Soloveitchik, is to get beyond some of the self-dramatizing melodrama in Soloveitchik's writing, right? To just kind of like be able to like get at what he's saying, as opposed to this kind of incredible, you know, I find myself lost and lonely, this very kind of mid-century existentialist way of writing. You gotta sort of move beyond that to get at something very basic he's saying. No, what do I do when I pray? I acknowledge that I'm lonely and I'm scared. And frankly, I know that I could like go outside and be hit by a bus or have a stroke or fall apart any minute. And prayer comes from that realization. My like irreducible vulnerability and dependence. That's prayer. When I can name and acknowledge that. Right? That is when I pray. Right? That's the argument. Now, you can't imagine two approaches to prayer that are more different. Right? One of them says, forget about the self. The other says, no, focus on the self in all its vulnerability. Right? So what is at stake in that? And source 8, by the way, basically says something similar. One of my favorite sentences in Soloveitchik, and I don't even know that I should do this, but it's one of the greatest sentences in 20th century Jewish thought, where he talks about the realization that I am, quote, bereft of an ontic fulcrum. Now, I don't know about you, but just this evening over dinner, I was wondering about my ontic fulcrum. But the point is, what that means, just to sort of translate that into like a normal person's language, is I don't know sort of what ground I'm standing on as a human being, right? That's just a kind of a ridiculous kind of philosophical way of saying, like, the anchor of my being is unclear to me. I'm just sort of thrown into the world. I'm scared. I'm vulnerable. I could get hurt. I don't feel grounded anywhere. And for Soloveitchik, the religious existentialist, right, what happens is eventually I discover God as that ontic fulcrum, right? Religious existentialists and existentialists start out from the same place. It's just that religious existentialists end up discovering, lo and behold, that there is something that can ground and hold them, which is why existentialists often disdain religious existentialists. Because as the church lady on Saturday Night Live used to say, well, isn't that convenient, right? Right? No, imagine Camus reading Soloveitchik and saying, wow, right? So you got the beginning, and then lo and behold, you found out that there's a transcendent God who loves you and hears your prayer. Well, that's nice. Please, let's not insult the word existentialist, right? Now, I don't think that's fair, because, right, Soloveitchik might say, I'm not sure that the criterion for truth is how much it makes you despair. Right? I'm just not sure that that's actually true, right? It may be that, in fact, I find myself lonely and I discover that there is truth and meaning in the universe, right? There's no reason I have to privilege your dark view of life, okay? Now, why is this, okay, so what is Soloveitchik really trying to do here, okay? He's going to try, and it's interesting, even he, and you can look at Source 9 for this, he wants to take the acquisitive edge off of petition, right? When I ask Hashem for something, it's not the thing that I'm trying to get that is primary, it's the acknowledgement of my vulnerability. I can't do it for myself, right? That's what I do when I petition. You take a modern person who is raised in all these kind of ridiculous, you know, narrative of the, you know, the self-made man. You know that amazing Mark Twain line? Self-made man is like a self-laid egg, right? Right? The self-made man, right? Like, comes Soloveitchik and says, okay, I'll tell you what, when your body is falling apart and you're scared and in pain, tell me you can do it all yourself. As opposed to saying, you know what, I need some help, right? Or the world is totally broken, right? And you're no longer a 19-year-old college student, so you don't believe that you can redeem the world, right? So like, God, can you help us? This is a nightmare. The world is an inferno. Help me, right? That moment, right? And here's where it gets interesting. Soloveitchik would say, I know you, Heschel, are going to tell me that I haven't overcome, I haven't self-transcended. But you're wrong. The self-transcendence of acknowledging how much I'm incapable of doing by myself and for myself is a radical form of self-transcendence. Have a bunch of modern people say, I can't do this myself. By the way, this is where, actually, in political thought, conservatives are often much more mature than liberals. Right? That is, in the acknowledgement of the limits of what human beings can do. What is Thomas Sowell's great line? In this world, there are no solutions, only trade-offs. And it's like such a profound insight into the human condition. I say that regardless of what your politics are. I'm talking about something, just a willingness to grapple with the limits of what we're capable of. Right? Soloveitchik suggests when you're willing to put down your utopianism, that's prayer. God, I can't. I need, but I can't do it myself. And the argument is, that is self-transcendence. Right? Because, and let's put it in modern ways, that's a way of putting down the modern self with all its illusions of omnipotence. Is that clear what I'm saying? Yeah, I think it's actually, and I think it's actually really worth wrestling with. Now, I want to take this one step further as a critique of Heschel. If you look at Source 10, there is one sentence in it: whoever permits his legitimate needs to go unsatisfied will never be sympathetic to the crying needs of others. This is an incredibly interesting challenge to the Heschel approach to prayer, right? Heschel basically says, what do? I realize that my ego is not the center of the universe. I focus on other, small o, capital O, and that makes me realize that I should put other people and other needs at the center of my universe. Soloveitchik says, if you don't have a discipline that is about acknowledging your own vulnerability, I'm sorry, but you will not know how to see other people's vulnerability. You're wrong. You will end up being a detached, otherworldly mystic. Now, empirically, he was wrong. Heschel was in some ways much less detached and otherworldly than Soloveitchik was. But that's not what we're talking about, right? A philosophy of prayer, right, is a really interesting claim. In other words, it's not just that I'm acknowledging to God that I'm vulnerable. It's that actually acknowledging my own vulnerability becomes a pathway to being able to acknowledge and respond to the vulnerability of other people. Right? If I can't admit that I'm vulnerable, the texture of my response to your vulnerability will always be, at best, condescending. Right? In my language here, some of you have heard me write about this, right? That is why I was talking about pity is fundamentally a vertical posture, whereas compassion is horizontal. Right? Pity is rooted in a refusal to acknowledge my own vulnerability. I could never be like you, right? And so I reach down to you. Compassion basically says, I'm human too. I could have the stroke you just had. My child could get cancer too. We could start getting really painful here, right? I could lose my wife. I'm totally here, right? Totally here because I know I'm vulnerable like you're vulnerable. Soloveitchik in this sentence is sort of throwing out the argument kind of in a very kind of almost passing way, but it's a very powerful argument. If you can't say, I have needs that I can't meet myself, you will not really know how to respond to people when they have needs that they can't meet themselves. And so petitionary prayer can be, I want to underscore can be, right? Can be also a form of ethical training. because the acknowledgement of my own vulnerability can make me a much more present human being. Although it's my goal to present them always, you know, as convincingly as I can, right? I'll say that on the first one, I'm actually in many ways much more sympathetic to Soloveitchik most of the time, and in what I'm about to say, I am totally unsympathetic to Soloveitchik, okay? Just to put my cards on the table, but I'm gonna try to present them as clearly as I can. So if you look for a minute at source one, the biblical scholar Terry Fredheim writes the following thing, which I totally love and has had a big influence in my own thinking. He says, it is not enough to say that one believes in God. What is important, finally, is the kind of God in whom one believes. The images used to speak of God not only decisively determine the way one thinks about God, they also have a powerful impact on the shape of the life of the believer. Now, we could unpack this at great length, but whether you believe God is a first cause or a dad, or whether you imagine God as the ultimate oneness of the universe or the transcendent creator of everything, which is not God, has implications for how you think about yourself, your spiritual life. These are not just kind of questions for a philosophy seminar room. They're questions that really affect the way you carry yourself and understand your life in the world. More than that, this is not Fredheim's point, but I'm going to make this point. You know, as a religious thinker, it's become very important to me to say, even though some people hear this as inflammatory, which I guess so be it, that's not my intention, is given how awful the God many people believe in is, right? I would prefer they be atheists than believe in that God, right? After all, I'm not that impressed with the statement, I believe in God. Osama bin Laden believed in God too, right? So the question is not, do you believe in God, but rather, what kind of God do you believe in? Or at least that seems to me to be a fundamental question. Which is why when people say, do you believe in God, I find that question personally just kind of boring. Well, what are you talking, what do you mean by that? Do you mean like an Aristotelian first cause? Do you mean a God who will wipe away the tears from every widow and orphan? What do you mean? What God are we talking about? Do you mean the kind of God who tells you to blow people up? Do you mean the kind of God who tells you that other people's needs and demands are illegitimate and you're the only, what do you mean? Okay, so Fredheim opens that up, that we should move beyond only saying, do you believe in God, to saying, what kind of God do you believe in? Now, one more thing to set the table. Bob Erlewine, who's a contemporary, you know, academic in the field of Jewish thought, makes a distinction that I think is helpful. You'll see what I mean in a minute, okay? He distinguishes between, just bear with me for this language, theocentrism in modern Jewish thought and neo-humanism. Theocentrism, right, is essentially the view that God is at the center and that everything else in the world that we're committed to has to be relative to my fundamental commitment to God, including my commitment to ethics. My commitment to ethics is secondary to, subject to, my primary commitment to God. For those of you who are into like popular Jewish thought, the two most dramatic theocentrists in 20th century Jewish thought are Soloveitchik and Leibovitch. One of whom was a very great thinker, and one of whom was a very influential one. I didn't mean that to be obnoxious, but meaning that's just, okay? But they were both dramatically theocentrists, right? It's all about my relation to God, and everything, including the ethical, is subject to that. Neo-humanists, according to Erlewine, right, are people who argue that really what's most real is the interhuman, that which happens between people, and God is at most a kind of way of talking about what happens between people. If you like this kind of stuff and you can make heads or tails of it, think Levinas, right? Now, what you already, if you know anything about Heschel, you already realize is he doesn't fit either of these categories very well, right? Because when Heschel says God, he means God. And yet his God is obsessed with the ethical, right? Erlewine is gonna argue, I think quite astutely, that one of the things that's Heschel's greatest contribution to 20th century Jewish thought is he basically says this distinction is ridiculous. And theocentrism that thinks that you can subject the ethical to God, right, is, well, bad theology at best and murderous at worst, right? So let's see how this develops. Okay, so let's talk about Soloveitchik for a minute. In his later essays, post-1961, happy to talk about why that is later, Soloveitchik becomes preoccupied with the Akedah, which he places at the very heart of his religious worldview. And he insists that, like Abraham, the believer is obligated, now to use his language, to withdraw and defeat himself. According to Soloveitchik, you can look at source 3 from the totally brilliant essay Majesty and Humility, quote, God tells man to withdraw from whatever man desires the most. It is true of the father of the nation as well as of plain ordinary people. Withdrawal is required in every domain in which man is most interested. Crucially for Soloveitchik, this includes the intellect. Since we cherish the intellect above all else, Soloveitchik thinks, because we believe our dignity is rooted in our intellect, it's a very kind of reading of Maimonides, right? Because we believe that the intellect is supreme in human life, the Torah requires us at times to simply suspend the authority of our intellect. Okay? To suspend the authority of our intellect. Now, just to be clear, Soloveitchik does not explicitly say that this includes moral reasoning. But he does speak about withdrawal in those areas in which man is most interested, to use his language, where the individual expects to find the summum bonum, where the person imagines his, you know, I'm using his because that's his language here, but I think you can easily transfer this to the human in general, right? Your vision of the good life might be, right, morals. Soloveitchik says, in order to really take God seriously, you have to at moments even surrender moral reasoning. At least I think that's what he's saying. He's certainly saying you have to surrender reasoning. I think, and I should say, most people who have read him think, that he's also saying that there are times when your moral reasoning needs to be suspended as an act of surrender to God. Now, what does this mean, right? You can look at source 9 where Soloveitchik says, ethics is heteronomous, meaning the notion that human beings just legislate the moral law themselves is ridiculous from Judaism's perspective. That's Adam's great sin, according to Soloveitchik. Ethics comes from God. It is inscribed by God into our hearts and consciousness. This is, for those of you who like this kind of thing, a direct assault on Kant, the notion that humans legislate the moral law for themselves. Heschel says, no, God legislates the moral law for us. Did I say Heschel? I meant Soloveitchik. So if God is the author of morality, and God tells us at times that we should withdraw and surrender our moral reasoning, then it seems like God can also at moments be the suspender of our morality, right? So it appears that he's saying that there are times in which we have to surrender our moral reasoning and our moral intuitions in the face of divinely revealed law. He does not explicitly ever say so, but it seems fairly clear that that's where he's going. The law seems to me to be morally troubling, and in that moment, I surrender to the law and acknowledge that God has the right to demand whatever God demands. Now, I won't develop this at any length. There are passages in Soloveitchik where he seems to argue that and then pull back in the very next sentence, which is a little bit how Soloveitchik works at times with this sort of push-pull. But it seems that that's the thrust, and for what it's worth, just so you think I'm not the only person who reads it this way, if you look at source 6, you see David Hartman, you know, understanding Soloveitchik in exactly that way. Do with that as you will. We are in a place where Soloveitchik is willing to say that in order to serve God, there have to be moments in your life when you are willing simply to subject your moral intuitions to God's will, or if you prefer, to suspend your moral intuitions in an act of faithfulness to God. Now, some people might find that very moving. Other people might find that extremely terrifying. And some people, interestingly, might find it both very moving and also quite terrifying, right? Now, it's moving, you could argue, because after all, so Soloveitchik argues, that's what it means to really put God at the center of my universe. It's terrifying because, wait, what kind of God am I putting at the center of my universe? Right? That's precisely the nub of the problem, right? So now, the assumption of this kind of approach is that there is a God who would, at times, require of me actions that suspend my moral intuitions about the world. That is a very large assumption. Okay? That, right? Clear? Right? The assumption is there is such a God who would require me at times to suspend my moral intuitions. More than that, this approach assumes that one of the most elevated moments of faith a human being is capable of, perhaps the most elevated moment, is precisely in that moment when he or she is willing to subject her moral intuitions to this higher divine will. The sound you hear in the background right now is Heschel screaming at the top of his lungs, right? Essentially saying, wait a minute, which God do you worship? Let me ask you a question. How many chapters in the Torah are about the Akedah? And how many chapters in the Torah are about a God who demands the ethical? Let's count. Okay, on your side, one. One. Still counting, I'm holding at one, Rabbi Soloveitchik. I'm holding at one. Right? Now, Soloveitchik responds to this, yes, but that one has resonance that's fundamental through the whole history of tradition. Heschel says, okay, but in contrast to your one, here, let me introduce you to that corpus called Chumash and Navi. Right? Where the argument is that God is obsessed above all else with the ethical. What does God love? Widows and orphans, right? Many of you have heard me quote this many times, Heschel's great line, right? Zeus loves women, but God loves widows, right? The greatest line, right? It's amazing, right? So with all due respect, Rabbi Soloveitchik, you know, I understand you're getting the transcendent God, but so what happens when you worship a God who deep down you know is less of a good character than you are? Right? That's the Heschel challenge to Soloveitchik, right? I would never say at the same time, it's not good for the human being to be alone, but you are biologically programmed such that the only thing that is good for you is to spend your life entirely alone. But God, the all-good, loving God, says that, and I suspend my moral intuition as an act of worship. Heschel says, have you read Terry Fredheim? Remember he said, what kind of God do you worship? In general, I don't suggest you worship a God who is morally less elevated than you. To which Soloveitchik's response is, and it's worth wrestling with this, right? Okay, that's fine, but at the end of the day, you're basically saying that the highest truth in the world is your own moral intuitions. So that's a form of self-worship. I'm telling you worship something that's not you, and you don't know how to do that. To which Heschel says, with all due respect, I became who I am and my moral intuitions were shaped by the fact that I inherited a canon that tells me to be obsessed about the ethical. So with all due respect, you're wrong. I don't have to worship a monster in order to, right, convince myself that it's God I'm worshiping. And at a certain point, the conversation breaks down right here. What is at stake in worshiping a God who's not me? So for Heschel, it's about the realization that there is a God who demands again and again and again, what about that person who's suffering? For Soloveitchik, it is about that, except when it's about something else, right? Which is, the ethical is not what's ultimate. God is. So God can at moments say, in this moment, the ethical is not the most important thing. To which, and here I really want you to understand, because I think this is fascinating. Heschel's argument is, that is moot. Because the point is that the God of Judaism would never do that, even if that God could do it. Right? The God of Judaism would never say, okay, abandon that person to her pain, because in this moment you have to subject your moral intuitions to God. Heschel says, who worships that? Certainly not. I mean, try selling that God to the prophet Jeremiah. Right? Try that. Now again, what Soloveitchik is saying is not stupid. And I think in a mostly liberal Jewish audience, it's important to emphasize this point. It's sort of about, at the end of the day, is what you do, take your ethical view of the world, make it ultimate, and then worship it. Now, I don't think that's a fair reading of Heschel, but it's a challenge that's important to wrestle with. I mean, this is one of the most amazing things about modern Jewish intellectual history. And I'm gonna get, someone is going to yell at me after the session for saying this, but I believe this is true completely. Modern Orthodox theology, at a certain moment in American Jewish history, is based on, amazingly, an internalization of Kierkegaard's misunderstanding of the Akedah. Now, just as they say in yeshivish, put that in your pipe and smoke it for a minute, right? Here's a guy, right? A person who says enormous skepticism about the conversation between Judaism and Christianity in a formal theological way. His understanding of the Akedah is totally read through Kierkegaard, who has a very distinct 19th century understanding of what the Akedah. The Akedah in the Bible is not about the suspension of ethics. Maybe I'll teach about that another year, or some of you may have heard Aaron Kohler talk about that the other night. It's just not about that. And amazingly, the authentic reading of the tradition that emerges in Soloveitchik and in a different register in Leibovitch is based on a Protestant misunderstanding of Genesis. Nobody before Soloveitchik ever said, Halakha is an Akedah. Nobody. Right? Here is a whole interesting thing about this. It is a fascinating way to deal with the challenge of modernity. After all, if you as a modern raise your hand and say, what about women? What about homosexuals? What about this? What about that? Soloveitchik can say, well, sometimes you suspend the ethical. And so it becomes a kind of rear guard defense against the modern challenge. Now, I suspect that the younger you get, the less compelling that approach becomes. That approach worked very powerfully at a particular moment in American Jewish life for a particular cast of modern Orthodox Jews. I think it works much less now. It works, yeah, although it doesn't, because you know, here's what happens. When you actually find yourself, I mean, look, I've had students say to me that they've effectively been told by a teacher of theirs, I know you're gay, and this is your Akedah. And at the end of the day, that becomes a harder thing to say the more time you've spent with actual people who are LGBTQ telling you their stories. Because all of a sudden you begin to wonder, you know, what God am I actually worshiping? Right? And so you begin to hear that birdie in your head saying, wait a minute, suspending my ethical intuitions? And also, of course, making other people experience an Akedah that you don't experience? Right? You should never make other people's pain the way you acquire your spiritual authenticity, right? That's really dangerous territory. The reason why Heschel would say the dichotomy between theocentrism, as Erlewine calls it, and neo-humanism makes no sense, is because what theocentrism means depends on what your theo is. What kind of God do you put at the center? If you put a God who really loves the vulnerable at the center, then you simply never have a moment where the suffering of the vulnerable becomes the price you pay for worshiping a transcendent God. You simply can't have that moment. It doesn't make any sense to have that moment. And at a certain point, that's where you are. Again, the cost of the Heschel approach is, someone like Soloveitchik can say, well, wait a minute, right? Where's the line between God and your highest values? To which Soloveitchik, of course, to which Heschel, of course, can respond and say, okay, fine, but if you end up with a God who's less ethical than me, what are you worshiping? Why am I more empathic than the transcendent creator of everything? I'm going to dive into that? I don't want to dive into that. And that's where the conversation ends on some level, right? And you have to sort of wrestle with where that dilemma is. Thank you very much.
Would be pleased to send a complimentary DVD of this program to anyone who wishes to support JBS, the Jewish Broadcasting Service, with a tax-deductible gift of $36, double chai, or more, to the nonprofit organization Jewish Education in Media. Simply visit the JBS homepage and click on the Donate button to make a donation by PayPal or your credit card. And please indicate the program for which you would like a DVD. Or you can send your tax-deductible check made out to GEM, Post Office Box 180, Riverdale Station, Bronx, New York, 10471. And again, please remember to indicate which program you would like to receive with our compliments. And we thank you for your kind support.